Hello guys, welcome back to Tesca Technologies Private Limited. My name is Shivam Vijay and today in this video I am going to give you a demonstration on AM/FM radio receiver trainer. In this video we will study the complete circuitry of the AM receiving or the AM radio receiving, the AM broadcaster channel, how they are received on a radio receiver. Also we will study the FM receiving, the frequency modulated broadcaster channel which are all over the world, how the channel and how the radio receiver receives them. The complete circuitry as printed on the circuit board, you will study it in the section. All the sections are described in this user manual also, and you will study all the circuitry with different type of test point provided on board and some components which are essential for forming the circuits. So all the design and all the purpose of this kit to give the easy understanding of complete circuit of both the type of AM and FM receiving. So now let us move on to the complete trainer circuit, in which I will explain you the complete circuit and the specification of this trainer board. Also we will do some basic test experiment, how we can calculate the gain measurement, frequency measurement, bandwidth measurement, different type of parameters that are related to this AM and FM radio receiving sections. So this is the basic AM and FM receiving radio station, the radio trainer. This comes in a complete wooden enclosure so that you can easily carry it at any of the place where you want to perform all the experiments, when you want to study it, and it is a very lightweight instrument, so you can easily carry it any of your place around. Like this, you can open the complete trainer board. Here the section wise diagram is also printed on the front section. The complete circuitry and all the components are on board so that you can easily study all the circuits, all the sections of first and second steps of the section of different waveform generation and waveform receiving with the antenna, of course, are given. The order code is 10905. You can use this order code to find out all the specification about this trainer board and to what you can learn from this by visiting our website, which is www.tescaglobal.com. Also we are offering a user manual in which complete study details about the training board or the complete testing procedure of different sections are given. A battery, which can be the FM trainer board, can be also operated with the 9 volt battery, and a power adapter at which the required power supply is provided with the power jack over here. And these are the complete accessories and setup of this AM/FM radio trainer. Now we move on to the complete section wise explanation of the complete circuit. The complete trainer board has a AM radio section which has a tuning range of 520 kHz to 620 kHz. IF frequency is intermediate frequency, which is set to 455 kHz, tracking for plus minus 3 dB to 700 kHz to 1400 kHz, 10 dB signal to noise at 200 microvolt typical. Talking about the FM radio section, which has a tuning range of 88 MHz to 108 MHz, intermediate frequency which is set to 10.7 MHz, tracking has plus minus 5 dB from 90 MHz to 106 MHz. Detector uses ratio detector and full time auto frequency control. 10 dB signals for noise at 12 microvolt typical. 9 sections are divided for audio amplifier circuit, AM detector circuit, AM IF circuit, AM amplifier circuit, AM mixer and oscillator circuit, FM detector circuit, first FM IF amplifier circuit, second FM IF amplifier circuit, and FM radio frequency stages. There are 15 test points, TP1 to TP15. Trainer is complete with earphone and operational instruction manual. Route speaker on the panel is installed and can be operative on the 9 volt DC voltage, which is provided with the battery, or either you can provide it from the adapter also. So now I will explain you all the section. All the sections that are printed on this front diagram of this AM AFM radio trainer are similarly placed on the PCB as described. So I will explain you the section wise explanation on working of all the sections. The AM-FM radio trainer is a receiver of standard amplitude modulation and frequency modulation broadcast frequencies. The actual assembly is broken into 9 sections. The purpose of section 1, the audio amplifier stage, is to increase the power of audio signal received from either detector to a power level capable of driving to a speaker. And now move on to the section 2. Includes the AM detector circuits and the AGC, automatic gain controller stage. The AM detector converts the amplitude modulated IF intermediate frequency signal to a low level audio signal using the AGC. The AGC stage feedbacks a DC voltage to the first AM IF amplifier in order to maintain the near constant level of the audio at the detector. Then this is fed to the section 3. The section 3 is the second AM IF amplifier. The second AM IF amplifier is tuned to 455 kHz and has a fixed gain at this frequency of 50. Then section 4 is the first AM IF 2 amplifier, which has a variable gain that depends on the AGC voltage receiver from the AGC stage. The first AM IF amplifier is also tuned to 455 kHz. Moving on to the section 5, includes the AM mixer, AM oscillator and AM antenna stages. When the radio wave passes through the antenna, it includes a small voltage across the antenna coil. This voltage is coupled to the mixer or converter, stage to be changed to a frequency of 455 kHz. This change is accomplished by mixing the heterodyning the radio frequency signal with the oscillator signals. So this was the complete section for the AM receiving. Now we move to the audio amplifier section, will be remain same for both the sections. And now the upper section is defined for the FM receiving. So the upper section, section 6, consisting the FM radio detector. The FM radio detector, has a fixed gain of about 20. Section 7, the second FM IF amplifier is the tuned to 10.7 MHz and has a set gain of approximately 20. The 3 dB bandwidth of this stage should be approximately 350 kHz. Moving to section 8 is the first IF amplifier for FM. And then the first FM IF amplifier is also tuned to 10.7 MHz and has a set gain of 20 as well. And the section 8 also has the 3 dB bandwidth of 350 kHz. Then we have section 9, includes the FM mixer, FM oscillator and FM RF radio frequency amplifier, automatic frequency control stage, and the FM antenna. All things are mixed and compiled with the complete section 9. The incoming radio waves are amplified by the FM RF amplifier, which is tuned to a desired radio station, is the FM frequency bandwidth of 88 MHz to 108 MHz, which can be tunable with the tuner provided on the trainer. And these amplified signals are then coupled to the FM mixer stage and then change to frequency of 10.7 MHz. This change, as in M, is accomplished by heterodyning the radio frequency signal with the oscillator signal. The AFC stage feeds back a DC voltage to the FM oscillator to prevent the oscillation from drifting. Each of those blocks will be explained in detail also in the theory section of the user manual. You can study it properly before working on the complete trainer. So here it is the front top view of this AM-FM receiver. In this we have the audio amplifier circuit which connected with the 8 ohm inbuilt speaker. The speaker provides output of the received signals, which we can hear it from this speaker. The switch is provided to change it from FM to AM mode or AM to FM mode. This is the switch provided here. Then this is the volume and on off controller. You just need to turn it into clockwise, sorry, anti-clockwise to turn it on and off it. So in the anti-clockwise, extreme counter-clockwise position, this will be in off condition, and in anti-clockwise position, this will be in the volume higher position and on position. Then we have a battery outlet or battery socket over here. We can connect a 9 volt battery which is provided with the complete trainer board, so that you can also operate the complete system. Will be operating on a 9 volt DC battery, but although the DC battery provides a low amplitude because the current passing through the battery will be slightly lower than the adapter. So I will prefer to use an adapter for working on this trainer kit. So now let us start with the first section of this complete trainer system, which is the audio amplifier. The purpose of the audio amplifier is to increase the audio power level to a sufficient to drive an 8 ohm speaker that I explained. To do this, DC current, direct current from the battery or the adapter is converted by the amplifier or an AC alternating current in the speaker. The ratio of the power delivered to the speaker and the power taken from the battery is efficiency of the amplifier. For the audio amplifier, we use the integrated circuit IC LM386. The complete schematic diagram is printed on board so that you can study it, also described in the user manual in the detail. The amplifier in our kit which is used has a gain of 150, also described in the user manual. The capacitor C40 couples the audio signal from the volume controller, and which is fed as an input to the audio amplifier. This is the amplifier circuit. Then the capacitor C43 blocks the DC to the speaker while allowing the AC to pass, and that's how speaker is driven and we can hear the sound. So firstly, we will do the power test of this FM AM radio receiver, in which the circuit diagram for power test is given. You have to make this configuration as described in this diagram. For this, the battery terminal, we are using the battery for this. The negative of the battery will be connected with the negative of the battery socket, and the positive of the battery socket will be going to common of the ampere meter. We required a milliampere meter in DC. For that, you can use this up to safety measurement for up to set the multimeter to 2 amperes of the DC range as described. Now we will connect positive to the common, and the positive of the meter will be connected with the positive of the battery or the battery socket. So that is how we have built up the connections right now on the trainer board. Here you can see that's the battery whose positive is connected to the common of the multimeter, and the other end of the multimeter we are going to connect this to the positive of the battery socket, and the negative of the battery is directly connected to the negative of the battery socket. Now similarly, we will connect the positive lead of the multimeter to positive end, and firstly we see the current in milliamperes on the multimeter. In the off condition there will be no current, and as we turn on the knob or the power supply using the volume on off controller, and then we increase the volume, we will see the current will be increased gradually in the meter, and that's how we will done our power test. So for this, firstly I will connect the positive to the positive of the battery socket, and right now you can see there is no current in the milliampere meter. I gradually turn on the knob and we'll observe the let me adjust the meter so that we can easily watch both. Now as I turn on the just I have turned on the knob, so that over here we have receiving around 10 or 6 milliamperes, and as I gradually increase the knob, we will receive the more current here. So the current drawing from the circuit is quietly increased as I am increasing the volume. So this is the maximum current which is drawing from this right now from the battery. This is around 36 or 37 milliampere current, and as the continuous circuit is going working, the current will be slightly increased due to the temperature. So that is how we do the power test. Again, turn off the knob and carefully remove all the connections. Now we move to the next test of this radio receiver. Now for second test, we are doing the static test. The power test comes in the static test of this complete radio receiver. After that, we will do the dynamic test also. Now, the second part of the static measurement will be the output bias test. For that, we just need to set the multimeter to the 9 volts reading to the read up to 9 volt DC. We have connected the battery properly in the battery socket right now, and now we will turn on the power knob or the volume knob, and we'll measure the voltages connecting ground to the TP15, which is the ground terminal of this complete radio receiver, and we'll connect the positive to the TP1. The TP1 will show the voltage between 3 to 6 volt. If we are getting this, so we can go on to the next test. And if our circuit test is failed, turn on the power off and check the integrated circuit is correctly inserted in the correct location or not. So firstly, we will connect the ground to the ground and turn on the trainer. Just slightly turn it on and connect it. So connect it to the TP1, and here we can see the voltages are 4.85. So it is in between 3 to 6 volts as described in the user manual. So we are getting the proper voltage. So our kit is power supply is perfectly working. Now we move on to our next test, which are dynamic measurement. So now moving to the dynamic measurements of the first amplifier circuit, in which we will firstly measure the gain of this circuit. For this we will connect a multimeter or VOM and a audio generator circuit as shown in the figure, also in the user manual, and I will explain you what I have done over here right now. So I have provided a audio signal of 400 hertz, because at the 1 kilohertz the multimeter will not be able to catch the proper signals. So we have reduced the frequency because the gain test will be also always done on the 1 kilohertz frequency for the AC gain, but multimeter is not able to catch up the 1 kilohertz frequency voltage. So we have set this to around 400 hertz. So we have set the 400 hertz in the frequency, the sine frequency, and the amplitude we have set is about the minimum, which is 0.1 VPP. Now it is fed to the TP number 2, test point number 2 over here. So test point number 2, which is as described in the user manual, we have provided a signal of 400 hertz with the 1.1 VPP of the amplitude. Now we have set the multimeter to the AC gain measurement, for which we will measure the AC voltage output, and we have set the multimeter already for this. And now we will turn firstly the power on, and we will read the AC voltage at TP1. So this is the TP1 over here. We are receiving right now is 0.1 or 0.11, 0.01 voltages. So we'll increase the audio controller about the half of the position. So we have set the audio controller to the half of the position. Now we check the again voltages is right now 0.2. Now we slowly increase the amplitude of the waveform that we have provided to this circuit till we reach the AC voltage about 1 volt on the multimeter. So we'll increase the amplitude slightly. So we have reached about 400 VPP. Now we'll increase the amplitude more slowly and gradually here. So we have received around 1 volt at 440 VPP of the voltage. We slightly adjust it more to be accurate. So at 435, we have received almost 1 volt AC voltage on the TP1. So at this time, now we move this positive probe to JP3 and let us measure the voltage over here. Let it completely down once it's stabilized. So here we are getting around 0.01 VPP or the 0.01 AC voltage on this point. So we note down these voltages in the observation. This is the V in volts, and to find out the gain, we just need to divide the V in by 1. So when we calculate 1 upon V in, which is our 0.01, so we'll get around 101 of the gain. So the calculated gain as described should be in between 100 to 180 as described in the user manual. So we have calculated the gain of the power amplifier circuit, which is around 100 for our case. Sorry, 101, because the reading is 0.011. So that is how you can calculate the gain for the dynamic measurement. Now we move on to the next measurement of this circuit. Now for the next dynamic measurement, we are going to measure the AC bandwidth. The AC bandwidth measurement, the circuit shows as described in the figure 9 in the user manual. We have to connect the oscilloscope on the TP1 test point. Similarly, the TP2 will be connected with the function generator as we done in the last test. Now, as described in the user manual, we'll connect oscilloscope and audio generator as described in the circuit, and audio generator frequency will be at the 1 kHz at the minimum voltage outputs, and we'll set the oscilloscope at the 0.5 per division volts per division. So we have set the oscilloscope for 0.5 volts per division, and we'll turn on the power and slowly increase the volume control to a comfortable level and increase the amplitude of the audio generator until the oscilloscope displays the 2 volts VPP peaks to peak. So we'll slightly turn on the level, and here we have slightly get the oscillations of the 1 kHz waveform right now. Now we'll gradually increase the voltage from the audio frequency generator, adjust the waveform at the middle so that we can get the proper 2 volts peak to peak adjustment here, just triggering is having variations. Now we'll slowly increase the voltages and make this up to 2 volts VPP. You can adjust the oscilloscope as per the requirement also. So here this is now 0.1 VPP. Sorry, this is about 1 volt VPP peak to peak. And if we increase this slightly more to reach up to 2 volts peak to peak, now again adjust the vertical position, and here we can see the voltages are right now peak to peak 2 volts. Around, and now at this time we have to move the oscilloscope probe to jumper 3 now for TP3, sorry, moving it from TP1 to measure the voltage at J3, jumper 3. This will be very lower voltages, so we need to adjust the CRO. For the voltage measurement at this point here, so 0.50 millivolts is right now at the volts per divisions, and we can say the voltages are right now 0.1 or 100 millivolts, 0.1 volt peak to peak or 100 millivolts peak to peak for both the section. Just need to carefully connect the probe on the circuit and we can get the proper output. So the voltages are very lower in the range, so we need to carefully measure the output, note down this value, and we can verify our gain, which is almost 100 for this as well. Now for bandwidth measurement, right now we can see this is at right now at the 2 VPP for this. For higher frequency of the bandwidth, we will increase the frequency from the audio frequency generator till the voltage from peak to peak will be dropped about 0.7. This should be around 1.4 peak to peak will remain, and we at this time will note the frequency. So we'll increase the frequency from the function generator till the output waveform drops about 0.7. Here we can see the outputs are now slightly dropping, so we'll increase slightly more. Yeah, we can see it is right now dropped up to 1.5 or 1.4. just need to adjust the level to properly matching it up. Here you can see the output is dropped from upper and bottom. This is right now about 0.7 from the original drop, and at this time frequency is about 35 kilohertz, so we'll mention this as a higher frequency. Now we again move the 1 kilohertz frequency, move to the 1 kilohertz frequency for this, and from here we'll again read the lower frequency. From this scale we again start the frequency decrement from here. At the higher frequency we have increased the frequency to drop out the level. Now we again decrease the frequency to dropping it out. Adjust the level slightly and check the voltage dropping. Yes, here you can see the voltage is slightly dropped about 1.7 for measurement. You can see, just adjust the level, and we can mention this is around 100 hertz, or we can say 200 or 150 hertz. So here mention this reading also, and when you calculate the bandwidth while subtracting the higher frequency from the lower frequency, so as we subtract the 35 kilohertz from the 100 hertz, we can get the 35 kilohertz around approximate value, and your calculated answer should be greater than 30 kilohertz, which is our answer right now from this calculation for AC bandwidth. So our calculation is right, and our practical or the test of this segment is also improper.
Now for see the distortion. Here we can see the output is around 1 volts from the function generator as well, and we have matched the output level is about 0.5 volts peak to peak. So we'll adjust this to 1 volt peak to peak. Here this is almost 1 volt peak to peak. Now for matching the distortions, adjust the level slightly. For seeing the distortion, we just need to turn the volume knob higher till we get the voltage proper, the sine wave will be proper form. At some time the peaks of the sine wave will start distorting. Here the peaks are continuously going up. Here you can see slight distortion starts in the peak. When you first occur the distortions, here you can see one half of the sine wave now starts to clipping. That's the distortion. The sine waves right now clipped. So at the point where distortions starts, we can measure the peak to peak voltage at this point, which are 0.5, 0.1, 0.15, 0.15, and this is almost about 0.175 of the maximum voltage, volts per division, after calculating it. So this is around 3 volts from up and down when we calculate it around peak to peak, and from more than 3 volts the waveforms starts decreasing or clipping. So we can mention that the 3 volts will be approximate value for this, at which our output will be undistorted. Now for measuring the efficiency of this complete setup, we are going to measure the current with the output supplied to this, and the circuit or the connections are described in the user manual. You can do it circuit as described in this. Also I have done the complete circuitry on the trainer board also. So for this we just need to connect the supply for measurement of current as we done it earlier, and we have to mention the current for the maximum output. Here the setup is as per done. Here we can measure the milliamperes on the multimeter properly, and just we need to connect the multimeter on the negative probe. The positive probe of the multimeter will be connected on the positive of the battery socket, and now we'll carefully increase the voltage or turn on the power from the trainer, and here we'll start seeing the ampere ratings, which is 56 milliamperes, 67 milliampere. So we'll increase the amplitude or voltage from the volume controller till the output is distorted or starts distorting. Here we can see the output is starts clipping. At this point we can mention the amperes, which are 100 milliampere for now. So we can mention this the maximum current as a maximum current for measurement of the current, and by calculating and putting the values as we have calculated the V clip in the last experiment, at where the voltage, at which voltage the output is start distorting, the maximum current at which the output starts distorting that we have measured right now, which is around 100 milliampere. Supply voltage, which is 9 volt from the volt batteries, which is completely measured. Now, after putting all the values in these formulas, we can calculate the efficiency of this FM receiver also.
Now, moving on to our next section, which is the AM detector stage. At this point, we will see the purpose of automatic gain control. This circuit is to maintain a constant level at the detector regardless of the strength of incoming signal. Without AGC, the volume control would have been adjusted for each section, and even moderately strong stations would clip the final IF amplifier, causing audio distortions. So that is how we can use the AGC, the automatic gain controller section. Now, for static measurement for AGC zero signal bias, with the power turn off, we'll connect the VOM at TP5. This is the TP5 point over here. This one. If you closely see the PCB, you will also find out the AGC, the automatic gain controller, written over here. So we'll connect the ground probe to the TP15 of the circuit and positive probe to the TP5 for measurement of the AGC. At this time, when we turn on the knob, the voltage should be around 1.5 of the adjustment. So at any of the point of volume control, the voltage will be remain constant, and that's how AGC will remain the constant and make a constant level to the complete circuit. So we'll turn on the circuit over here, and we can see the voltage is about 1.3.48, and when we turn the knob completely to the maximum output here, the constant voltage remains around the circuit at any of the point. So that is how we can measure the and check the AGC on this point at TP5. So that was the AGC zero signal bias test for static measurement. Now we'll do the T8, the transformer 8 test. For this test, with the power turned off, we'll connect the positive lead to the TP3, which is the test point for this transformer. And at this time, the voltage will be zero. When we turn on the supply of the controller, the voltage at this point will be the output from the battery voltage. This is around 9 volts. So we'll check this using the multimeter. For this, we need to set the multimeter for DC measurement up to 9 volts. And now we turn on the power. And here we can see the voltages are around 8.4, which is the output voltage from the battery, which are power source for this section. If I increase this, the voltage remains constant, and here our test of T8 is successful. So that was the section 1 and 2 of AM radio receiver. Now we move on to the second IF amplifier, which is section 3 in this. For this, the purpose of second IF amplifier to increase the amplitude of the intermediate frequency, and at the same time it provides the selectivity. Selectivity is the ability to pick out one radio station while rejecting all others. The second IF amplifier T8 or transformer acts as a band pass filter with a 3 dB bandwidth of approximately 6 kHz. The amplitude versus frequency response of the second IF amplifier is shown in the manual. You can study it already, and we will do the static measurement also for that. So we'll check the Q9 bias for that, because the transformer T8 is, and the DC current in Q9 will be the current set by the resistors or the complete second IF amplifier. This is the circuit diagram for the Q9 bias test. We just need to connect the multimeter to TP3, and we'll turn on the radio station or the radio receiver, and then we check the voltage. The voltage should be around 1 volts. So we have set the voltmeter for for measurement of DC range. And now we will turn on the radio trainer and we'll check the voltage at Q9's emitter. This should be around 1 volt. So we'll connect ground probe to the TP15, which is our ground point, and we'll connect the positive probe at the emitter of Q9. Here they are receiving around 1 volt in the multimeter. So our transistor and the complete IF circuit, or the second IF circuit, is now working. Q9 is in proper bias condition. Now we'll do the AC gain measurement test. Now for AC gain measurement test, we need to build the circuit as described in the user manual. This is the connection. We need to connect the generator using a 0.001 microfarad capacitor with the TP4. So we'll connect a capacitor like this, and at the TP3 we will measure the oscilloscope on output waveform. We need to set the function generator at the 455 kHz with no modulation and minimum voltage output, and we'll set the oscilloscope at 1 volts per division. So we'll do the connections, all the connections. As you can see right now, I have done already. Now we'll do the settings. The oscilloscope probe will be connected on TP2. Right now, first we will turn off the radio trainer using the on-off controller. So oscilloscope probe will be connected on TP3, and when we turn on, before that we will set the function generator and oscilloscope settings. So here we have set the 455 kHz in the sine wave, and amplitude will make it minimum around 0.1 VPP, and the oscilloscope is set at to 1 volts per division right now. So we'll set the level also for the beam at the 0. Now we'll turn on the radio trainer and slowly increase the amplitude of the signal till we reach the 4 volts peak to peak on the oscilloscope. So we'll turn on the trainer, adjust the level slightly here. Here our waveform is now visible at a very low amplitude. Now we'll increase the amplitude slowly till 4 divisions. Here the waveform is almost about 4 volts, as our DSO is set around at the 1 volts per division. So waveform which is showing has now covered 4 volts, 4 divisions peak to peak. So plus 2 and minus 2 is around 4 volts peak to peak, as we need to set it. So we have set the voltage. Now we'll adjust the transformer T8 using a screwdriver or a aligner tool to make a peak of this output waveform. So here we have a screwdriver, and this is the T8 that need to adjust very carefully. Slowly we can adjust it to set it to the peak of the first peak. Here at this, the peak is arrived and it's now start decreasing. So we will set it to the peak wherever the first peak, when you adjust and align the T4, reaches. Now we again decrease the amplitude and make it again 4 volts PPP. So here our output is now 4 volts peak to peak and mention the voltage in the generator, which is 0.300 VPP. Note down this voltage in the user manual. So after again setting the amplitude and make the 4 volts VPP, after adjusting the T8 and aligning the T8 transformer, we just move the oscilloscope probe from the T3 terminal to the base of Q9. At the base we will find out the voltage levels. What are the voltage levels of peak to peak or the DC, whatever we're getting. We'll see, this is at 0.2 volts per division right now, and we are receiving around 1/5 of 0.2 volts. So we'll mention this VB voltage in the user manual. So as the calculation, the VB, the base voltage of the Q9 that we have measured, is around the 0.2 divided by the 5, as it is the fifth division of 0.2 volts per division. So our division of one line, which is about 0.2 volts, and our output is around the 1/5 of this. So if we mention it there, we'll get in the output, which is 0.04 VPP. So 0.04 VPP is our base voltage after calculating it. Now for calculating the gain, we just need to divide 4 divided by VP, the VB, the base voltage. So when we calculate it, 4 divided by VP, 4 divided by 0.04, we'll get the gain of around 100. So our gain should be 100 or more than 100 in this case. So our gain is accurate. That's how we calculate the gain, AC gain of this audio amplifier. Now for the next dynamic test, which is the bandwidth test. The bandwidth test will be do same as the last bandwidth test that we have performed. We just need to build the same circuit for output calculation. T8 need to be aligned for the maximum output, and just need to increase the frequency of RF generator at which the voltage of the TP3 is dropped about 0.707, and then you ensure and note down the frequency, and again we'll increase the frequency of generator to pass the peak, a point where the signal drops to 0.707 of its peak value. Then we record the higher value again, and by subtracting the frequency of lower corner from the higher frequency, you will get the bandwidth. So same procedure we need to follow for that also. So we will not explaining it by practically, just I have explained it in your theory. The practical will be same as we performed earlier. Now moving to section 4, the first AM IF amplifier. The operation of first AM IF amplifier is the same as the second IF amplifier, with one important difference. The gain of the first IF amplifier decreases after the AGC threshold is passed to keep the audio output constant at the detector and prevent overload of the second IF amplifier. So IF amplifier, first IF amplifier prevents the load for the second IF amplifier. Now we will do the static measurement. The circuit and the descriptions are also given in the theory, you can read it out. In the static measurement, we will check the Q8 base bias voltage. We will connect the multimeter as shown in the earlier circuit. We'll set the multimeter to read 2 volts DC and then turn power on. The voltage at TP5 should be approximately 1.5 volts. So we'll do this, and after that we'll check the Q Q8 current also. For that we'll measure the voltage at the meter of Q8 and we'll connect the negative at TP15. Then we will measure the voltage that should be approximately 0.8 volt, and since the current is Q8, in Q8 is equal to the current in R37, so we'll calculate the resistance, the current by using the voltage divided by resistance, and it should be approximately 8 milliamperes. Now we'll do the basic static measurement test using the multimeter that I have placed over here. So we'll set the multimeter for DC measurement, turn on it and turn on the power also. So we'll first check the Q8 voltage. For this we'll connect the Q8 at ground should be going to TP15, and here we have received around 1.3. we can say it is the approximate voltage of 1.5 at the Q8. Now we'll measure the voltage at emitter of Q8. For this, we'll connect the multimeter to ground, and emitter over here is showing around 0.7 or 0.8 volts. So we'll calculate the current using R37 over here. The R37 is about 1 kilo ohms. So we can get the output current is 8 milliamperes for this Q8. Now for the dynamic measurement, the same procedure as the second IF amplifier should be followed. Generator should be connected using 0.01 microfarad capacitor at the TP6, and at TP4 we can calculate the output waveform. Here we just need to do one change in the circuit, which is using a clip lead, we need to short TP3 to R38 to prevent the AGC from lowering the gain of the first amplifier. So this short point need to be done, and then same procedure need to be followed as per the last practical. So we have done the circuit over here. We have provided a 455 kilohertz frequency as we done it in the last practical also, connecting using a 0.001 microfarad capacitor at TP6. We have short circuit the point R38 resistance with the TP3, and now we are ready to measure the output waveforms at the TP4. Oscilloscope is set at the 1 volts per division here. Now we'll start increasing the amplitude till we get the 4 volts peak to peak on the output. So this is right now 4 volts peak to peak. Now we again align the T7 so that we reach the first peak of this. So this is the maximum peak output. So we just need to just slightly adjust the peak voltage for this. If you are not able to adjust this, you just need to change the amplitude again and you will get it in proper manner. Just increase the amplitude some more and find out the peak of this T7. Yes, we have reached the peak value now. Again, we'll decrease the amplitude to make this around 4 volts peak to peak. Here, this is now 4 volts peak to peak. At this point, we will remove the test probe or oscilloscope, and now this will be connected to the Q8 base. So base of Q8 that we connected over here. Now we'll find out the voltage level. So this is at 0.1. Here we can calculate the peak to peak of this waveform, which is the base output, and if we consider the it is 0.1 volts peak to peak, or the 0.1 volt per division, we can consider it 1/5 of 0.1. So we'll calculate and mention the base voltage in the user manual. Now after calculating the base voltage, we can consider the base voltage is 0.1 divided by 5 sections that we have seen in the waveform. So we'll consider the VPP or the base voltage is about 0.02 for this, and when we want to calculate the gain, we just need to divide the VB with by 4. So 4 divided by VB, and when we get the gain should be greater than 100. At this time the gain is around 200, which is the first IF amplifier. The second IF amplifier, in the second IF amplifier, the gain slightly goes down. So that's how we can calculate the AC gain of this section as well. Now after that, we are moving to the last section of AM radio. For this, AM mixer, AM oscillator and AM antenna are the last in the section 5. So for static measurement, Q7 bias, we will test the Q7 bias test as described. We just need to short circuit the point TP6 to the collector of Q7, and then we measure the voltage at TP7 as described, and then we calculate the dynamic measurement for AM oscillator circuit. So we'll first do the static measurement using the multimeter. So as described in the user manual, we have short circuit the point TP6 with the collector of Q7, and now we will do the static measurement test using the multimeter. We will measure the voltage at test point 7 after turning on the radio trainer, and this should be around 1.5 volts if the biasing is proper. So TP7 is we are going to connect over here. So we'll turn on the trainer and we'll connect the multimeter at TP7. So here we can see the voltage is around 1.427 in DC. So that's how our Q7 biasing test is successful. Now we remove this short circuit and do the dynamic test measurement AM oscillation on the oscilloscope. Now for dynamic measurement of AM oscillator circuit, we have connected the oscilloscope at the collector of Q7. Remove already the short point or the short link that we have performed earlier. Now we'll turn on, make sure the oscilloscope is first set at 1 volts per division, and now we'll turn on the radio trainer. Over here we'll receive a very low amplitude sine wave, and when we move the tuner gauge, the sine wave shape will also changes according to the tuning. We can also increase the amplitude with the volume controller. So as in India, amplitude modulation is now not very in practice, and also not broadcasted on amplitude modulation. So that's why we're not receiving any of the signals for the amplitude modulation, so that we cannot perform the output of the amplitude modulated waveforms. So this is the all about of the amplitude modulation receiver using the radio trainer. Now we move on to the FM section. We will study section by section as we study in the amplitude modulation, and then after we will try to catch some frequency modulated waves. Now moving to the section 6, the FM radio. Section 6 begins the construction of the FM radio. The stages that we have built are shown in the block diagram. We will begin with the ratio detector and work back to the FM antenna. Each stage will be tested before proceeding to the next stage. FM ratio detector. In the FM ratio detector section, we observe that the audio wire is detected from the changes in amplitude of the incoming signal. In the FM detection, the audio is detected from the changes in frequency of the incoming signal. The ratio detector has built-in limiting actions which limit signal so that any noise riding signal of FM carrier will be minimized. The ratio detector is redrawn below for the ease of explanation. So this is the basic ratio detector circuit which is redrawn for understanding. All the theory or working of the ratio detector is provided so that you can study it properly. Now we'll do the static measurement of this. For this we'll first check the FM voltage. So for this we'll connect the digital multimeter as shown in figure 27 at R25, which switching the AM FM switch to FM position, and then we set our VM to read 9 volts DC. Then the power on and the voltage at this point should be around 7 to 9 volts. We'll do this test. After that we'll do the transistor current test. Now for FM voltage test, we'll first turn on the knob using the volume controller, and we'll connect it to the TP15, the ground of the multimeter, and positive will be connected at R25. So here we are receiving around 7 volts, so our power or the FM voltage is correct. If there are some fluctuation, you can check some of the components described in the user manual. Now for transistor current test, we will first measure the voltage at Q6 emitter. For this we'll turn on the circuit, connect ground to TP15 and positive to emitter of Q6. Here note down this voltage in the multimeter, which is around 0.596. we can see it 0.6. for this, if the voltage is more than 2 volts, we need to check some of the components also described in the user manual. Now for calculating the current, you just need to do this equation. The Q6 voltage that we have measured is around 0.7 divided by R22, which is our resistance from the current is passing through the emitter. So write down its value and you will get the calculated current, which should be around 0.005 amperes or 0.5 milliamperes in the range. Now for AC gain measurement test, we have adjust the CRO and function generator as described in the user manual. We have provided a function generator output at 10.7 megahertz of the frequency at C20 or the T3, which is the tuning transformer, and the output will be taken at TP8 from the oscilloscope. So all the arrangements and connections has done. You need to require some adjustable settings for that, because the kit is rightly compact, so that all the connections and props need to be carefully connected so that it did not short any of them with each other. Now we'll adjust the amplitude, and from lower to the higher, we have set the oscilloscope to 50 millivolts per division, and we'll carefully increase the amplitude till we reach about three divisions of, or we can say 150 millivolts per division peak to peak. So we have set the oscilloscope for 50 millivolts per division, and we have set the function generator for 10.7 megahertz of the frequency with amplitude around 0.1 VPP. Now we will provide the amplitude to the trainer and we'll observe the output on the oscilloscope. We'll increase the amplitude gradually, and here you can see the sine wave is increasing. So we'll try to make this about 3 divisions to be covered. So we'll adjust the level slightly. This is right now at 2 divisions, so we'll increase it some more. So this is the maximum output from our function generator. Now we'll align this using the aligning tool. So using the aligning tool, we'll try to carefully increase and take a peak of this. So here this is the almost peaked output, and there is no change in the 3 divisions or the peak because the amplitude is very higher and we have almost same value. So at this time we need to remove the oscilloscope test probe from the TP8 and we'll connect the oscilloscope probe at base of Q6, and at this time the waveform that we are getting over here, we'll need to mention the peak to peak voltage of this waveform. So this is around 50 in negative and 50 in positive, so this is around 100 millivolts peak to peak. So we'll mention this in the user manual and then as a VB, and then we calculate the gain. So after calculating the voltage, mentioning it at the VB that we have calculated around 10 millivolts, so 100 millivolts I was wrongly calculated. That was at the 5 millivolts at that time, 5 volts per division, and we have received the 2 divisions, which is around 10 millivolts. So 10 millivolt VPP will be the base current, and AC gain will be calculated 150 divided by 10 millivolts VPP, and our gain will be around 15 for this. So the gain should be approximately 20 or near about 20. 15 can be considerable gain for this. The output of waveform of VB should be around 5 for the proper output. So when you do the practical, you just need to adjust proper adjustment and you will get the proper gain of the circuit. So that's how we calculate the AC gain. When you calculate the answer, dividing 150 millivolts dividing by VB, you will get approximately 20 gain of your circuit. So that's how the AC gain of dynamic measurement has been carried out for section 7, second IF amplifier, All the conditions should be same for measurement of Q5 biasing. Also, you can again measure the AC gain as the same method as I described. Bandwidth also you can calculate as the earlier method, in which we have find out the bandwidth from higher to lower end using the oscilloscope and function generators. Similar practical will be also performing in the section 8. Now we move on to the last section, which is section 9, the FM RF amplifier, mixer oscillator and AFC stage. So in section 9, it is a super heterodyne receiver. The radio waves are emitted and then mixed with the local oscillator to produce the intermediate frequency, which is working at 10.7 MHz. The first stage is the RF amplifier, which selects the radio station and amplifies it. The second stage is the local oscillator, which oscillates the frequency at 10.7 MHz above and the desired radio station frequency. The third stage is the mixer stage, where the amplified radio waves are heterodyne with the local oscillator. During the mixing process, a different frequency is used as a So in the section 9, we have FM RF amplifier, mixer, oscillator and AFC stage. It is a super heterodyne receiver. Waves are emitted and mixed with the local oscillator. Local oscillator oscillates the frequency at 10.7 MHz to produce the intermediate frequency. Then the third stage is the mixer stage, where the amplified radio waves are heterodyne with the local oscillator. During the mixing process, difference frequency is used in IF in FM radios. The collector of transistor Q3 contains an IF transformer T1, which is tuned only to difference frequency. This transformer rejects all frequency except those near about 10.7 MHz. T1 is also coupled to 10.7 MHz signal to the first FM IF amplifier. The RF amplifier and oscillators are the only two resonant circuits that changes when the radio is tuned for different station. So this is the complete circuit diagram, in which all the four of them, FM, RF amplifier, mixer, oscillator and AFC stages are combined. We do the AC gain test. Before that, we will check the Q3 biasing. For that, we'll use the multimeter connected to the TP13 and we'll get the voltage approximately 1.8 volts as described in the user manual. If your answer varies more than 2 volts, then turn off the power and check the component R7, R8, R11 and Q3. So we'll do this test. For this, we are using the multimeter as described. We'll connect the ground to the TP15 and positive to the TP13. So for this, we'll turn on the trainer. Connect this to TP15, the ground, and this is the TP13 terminal over here. Here we will getting the voltage around 1.58, we can say it is 1.6 around. So this is near about 1.8, so our Q3 biasing is good. Now we move to the AC gain measurement test. Now we have built up the circuit as described in the figure 36. We have connected the function generator at 10.7 MHz around frequency at TP13, and we are observing the output using oscilloscope at TP12. The oscilloscope is set at 10 millivolts per division. Right now you can see the position is horizontal at the minimum value of the amplitude. Now we'll increase the amplitude of the waveform from the function generator to make this around 40 millivolts or 4 divisions peak to peak. We'll increase it, adjust the level slightly here. So we have almost reached 4 divisions peak to peak. Slightly more adjust this to get proper variations. As the waveform is of megahertz frequency, so this is slightly less visible. Now we'll use a liner tool to adjust the T1 transformer for the peak. So this is the alignment tool, and we'll adjust the T1 carefully for the peak value. So here there is no variation in the output, so at this time we can consider it at the minimum output voltage. Now at this stage we will move the scope probe to the base of Q3 and find out the voltage. This is around 5, or almost this is around 10 millivolts for this. Mention this in the user manual. So here, after putting the value 10 millivolts VPP of the base voltage, we can calculate the AC gain, which is 40 millivolts divided by VB, which is 10 millivolts. And when we divide 40 divided by 10, we will find out your calculator answer should be around 3. So we are our answer around 4. So gain is more than 3, which is a very good output gain for our circuit. So that's how we can calculate the AC gain. Now moving to next, we are now about to test the starting measurement of Q2 bias. So Q2 bias will be depending on the bias voltage of Q2. For that we'll require a multimeter. We'll connect it and we should read about 4 volts at Q2. So we'll select and set up the multimeter for that. So here we have set the multimeter and circuit is turned on. Now we'll connect this to the base of Q2 and measure the voltage over here. This is 5 volts DC from the output, from the base, and measured by multimeter. So our voltage should be around 4 volts. So this is right now around 5 volts. So this is okay for this. So Q2 biasing is perfectly done and going on properly. Now we move to the next test. Now we will study about AFC, automatic frequency controller. When the radio is tuned to a station, it would desirable for the radio to lock on the station. Due to changes in the temperature, voltage and weather effects, the local oscillator may change its frequency. 10.7 MHz will not be maintained. Automatic frequency control is used to maintain the 10.7 MHz center frequency. When the local oscillator drifts, the radio detector will produce a DC correction. The audio signal rides on the network, which removes the audio so that the pure DC voltage produced. This voltage is fed to the special diode called varector. A varector will change its internal capacitance when the voltage is applied. The ratio detector diodes are positioned in such a way that when the 10.7 MHz center frequency increases, the DC correction voltage will decrease. Likewise, when the 10.7 MHz center frequency decreases, the DC correction voltage will increase. This voltage change causes the capacitance of varector change, causes the capacitance of the varector to change. So that's how DC correction generally works. We'll also observe this using and finding forming this circuit. So generator, audio frequency generator is connected using 0.001 microfarad capacitor at TP15, and this is the AFC point on the trainer that at where we have to measure the voltage VD1, and then after we'll increase the frequency, then see the voltage slightly changes for adjusting itself, and again we'll decrease the frequency and change the voltage variation also. So this is the complete setup that we have done over here. Now using the positive probe at the AFC point, we'll turn on the trainer. This is the voltage 9.29 at this time at the frequency 10.7 megahertz. Now we will increase the frequency slightly and see what is the effect here. As I increasing the frequency, the voltage decreases. Now we again set frequency to 10.7. here this is again 9.29. now we'll decrease the frequency over here and see the voltage increment. This is 9.30. we'll continuously decrease the frequency to again reach the original value, which is 9.29 or 28. So that's how the AFC, the automatic frequency control, changes the voltage of varector, and we can achieve the continuous log movement of receiving stations. And now we will do the last biasing test of this section, which is Q1 biasing. For this, turn on the trainer and measure the voltage connecting ground on the TP15 and positive on the base terminal of this Q1. Here you should receive around 1.6 volts, and our voltage is near about in the range of 0.5 from the difference, so we can consider it okay. But voltage should be in proper way. It is around 1.6-1.7 in the output. So that's how our Q1 biasing is done. Now we will try to find and match the frequency of this audio frequency or the AM radio trainer. Right now in India, FM broadcasting is going on, so we'll try to catch up the broadcasting frequency. For that, just need to adjust the volume control, and you need to adjust these five of the coils or the transformer for getting the proper output. Mainly these two transformer will work. So you need to be very patient while working and observing this. When you receive some of the frequency near about, rest of the channels will also be observing. Thank you. Carefully adjust the gain tuner for tuning it. We are almost about to matching and tuning up the radio tuner. So that's how we have received some signals after some adjusting of all the 4 and 5 gains over the transformers. Just need to adjust the gain tuner properly to get the proper output, as it is a training purpose FM receiver, so that some distortion will be always present there. This is just to study the output. Right now, some of the receiving stations we are receiving right now. This is the other one. So after adjusting it, you can receive around 10 to 15, whatever the higher frequency differences channels for communicating it with the your radio stations, it will be easy to receive the farther frequency. The frequency difference in which are more, the closer frequency stations are a bit difficult to catch up for this. So this is how the FM and AM radio trainer works for this. So here our demonstration of AM FM radio receiver or radio trainer is now completed. I hope you got the proper information and proper knowledge how you can do your test and your measurements on this complete trainer. And if you still find difficulties while working with this trainer kit, you can contact to Tesca Technologies Private Limited for all type of supports. Also, if you like the content of this video, if you find it useful and you got some knowledge with this, you can like this video. Also, you can share this video to your friends, to your colleagues, to your classmates, those who want to learn about AM/FM radio receiving technologies. Also, you can also subscribe our channel, which is Tesca Tech on YouTube. There are a lot of videos with different types of practical experience and practical descriptions are uploaded. So you can go through that and clear out your different interesting topics of education. Don't forget to press the bell button also. So whenever we upload our new video with a new trainer, with a new technology, explaining practically in that, you will find out the notification about that as well. Till then, thank you for watching this video and we'll meet in the next video very soon.